All right, we understand that Leo Laudenslager is just about to mount
there
up, as they say. He's strapping his plane on, I guess, Ed.
He's getting ready. Well, look at that propeller going.
Riddle me this, Batman. In the trivia that I was reading about this event, it said that the last actual air races were in 1985, and the air race was won by 8 inches.
Here he goes.
8 inches.
Nose to nose, huh?
Isn't that incredible?
That's amazing.
Here he goes. Tell us about this plane now. We're seeing Leo going up right here. Now, he designed this plane himself.
It's a modified Laser 200 aircraft, and he's done all kinds of things in it to make it roll faster, go higher, quicker, and all the rest of that. And then there's a series of snap rolls right on takeoff. At about 100 miles an hour.
This weighs about, 850 pounds?
You got it.
Okay. And he's going how fast?
Well, his show goes anywhere from about 220 miles an hour down to zero when he gets up to the top of the maneuvers. And
tell us about these maneuvers. Tell us what
he's just doing a nice series of slow rolls as he lets the nose down, coming down the line there, and then it reverses it back and forth, a little snap roll to the left, inverted down the flight line. And he's about 100 feet in the air now. And as we were talking about G's earlier, you know, when you got somebody sitting on your lap, well, now suppose it's the other way around, you know. He's on the outside there. All the blood is rushing up to his head, and you have a situation instead of blackout, red out.
He said last year he put a new canopy on this to make it go faster.
A little lower profile and some of the lighter maneuvers. And I tell you, you know, when you watch Leo Laudenslager, you got to get into it. When this guy gets going and you watch him fly, he really starts me up.
Your heart started and I wanted
absolutely.
This fella has won what, 7 national titles, even a world championship, which you're watching right here on your screen now, is one champion.
Hey Deke, didn't he take the championship last year?
Sure did. He talked here at the Cleveland Air Show. He won the Clifford Henderson Award, which is the big prestigious award they give every year to one of the folks here at the air show, and he got it. Also this year, what, Hall of Fame for the International Acrobatic Club.
I've got a quote here, Eddie. This is a quote from Laudenslager himself. Flying aerobatics requires a different type of psychological equipment. You kiss the ground with the wrong attitude, and that's the last time. You don't get any second chance.
That's right.
Well, he makes it sound scary.
He does, but I tell you, as many times as Leo has done this show, I was talking to him just about an hour ago. We were over in a hangar having a Coke, and a Bud Light. And, you know, he still goes through the same routine every time. He's got a script in front of him. But they call him Mr. Madness because this is the fastest act in the air.
Is he crazy?
No. He just really acts crazy. He's
got
it totally under control.
Tell me what he's like on the ground. I mean, is this a daredevil on the ground, too?
Very much like our Mr. Sweeney here in terms of of a nice, casual, easygoing guy. You know, no ego, no vanity, no I'm wonderful, I'm unique. Just
this
an ordinary guy.
This guy, somebody told me, likes to be alone before he gets into that suit and gets into that plane.
Only because he goes through in his mind everything he does. Now, obviously, this is not a competition, and he says he gets a little nervous before some of the competitions because if you look at his airplane, he's actually got a window in the bottom of his airplane because when he's doing some of these maneuvers, you have to be exactly perpendicular, exactly parallel, or exactly angled to a runway or to a ground reference. So he looks down. When you're going straight up, you have to be going absolutely perfectly straight up. This is kind of a relaxed show for him, but by the same token, he still goes through that same mental preparation. He walks around the ground, does everything in his mind because he doesn't have time to read the cue card in front of him.
When he flies upside down, what is that like to be upside down?
All the blood is going to your head. It's a little unnatural because you're hanging in the harness instead of sitting on a seat. It's just like, you know, going to a ride in a fair at Cedar Point or someplace like that and just hang it. Oh yeah, you get used to it, and you don't do it for very long.
Wow, what's this?
He went straight up in the air and actually just ran out of airspeed. And let, as we were talking earlier, Mother Nature take over. The heavy end came down first.
Now, how high off the ground was he when he finally pulled out of that?
He pulled out here about 75 to 100 feet. And he could go there, but then the crowd couldn't see. So he stays up high enough to make it look spectacular, well, low enough to make it look spectacular, and high enough so everybody can see it here.
Has he ever had a crash in one of these shows?
No. Matter of fact, he hasn't. And he modifies his airplane constantly. It's been basically rebuilt, you know, three or four times. And he's got a little enhancement device on the outside of when people come out and see it, and you can get pretty close to this airplane. There looks like a shovel on the outside, and it's called a spade underneath one of his ailerons. Those are the things that make airplanes roll. That makes it go faster.
Could he tell if somebody tampered with his plane?
Oh, yeah. There he is now. See, he's just hanging on the propeller there now.
Wow.
And he doesn't have that greater than 1-to-1 thrust-to-weight ratio.
How is he doing this? How do you do that?
You just pull it straight up, and then eventually, because you don't have enough thrust to keep you going up, the airplane just starts coming back down, right at the called a tail slide. And they're about 10 feet into the air and straight up into some left aileron rolls. Now he's perfectly perpendicular to the runway. Over on his back, about 2,000 feet above the ground, straight down to the runway, and about 500 feet.
Pull out Leo.
That'd stop your heart. My God.
Sure does.
Do the clouds here make any difference to him on how he flies?
No, actually, it makes it more beautiful to the people on the ground. It doesn't really bother him at all.
You know, I got to tell you something. Last week, it was a toss-up whether Connie or myself were going to go up on in a T-34 mm-hmm. Navy plane. And this guy, once we were up there, allowed me to fly this thing. And the steering on it was nothing sloppy like the Piper or Cessna or anything else. It actually handled like a sports car. And I got to believe this plane has got some critical steering in it.
Absolutely. I mean, when you think left, it's gone.
You don't have to move the stick, just think left.
That's right. And equally as important, though, once you get it going, you got to stop it. Because again, if you look at the crispness of his maneuvers, and again, what you saw in your flight, military style acrobatics, you know, you really want to be precise. And that's how you tell the average from the expert.
And maneuverability here is the key with him, not speed, right? He wants to keep this right in front of the folks here for the show so they can see everything
right.
He does.
We've got 6,250 feet of runway here at Burke Lakefront, and he's not using half of it either.
Wow.
But no matter where you are out here tomorrow, ladies and gentlemen, or Monday, since this is a great Labor Day show, as Leo Laudenslager goes straight up doing a four-point hesitation. Now watch, he's going to do this again.
Okay.
He's pulling up, and he's pushing over the top before he runs out of speed. Just push forward on the stick, and it's right straight back down the same line.
How much fuel does he use for a show like this?
Oh, he just uses a few hundred, maybe 100 gallons. That may be one of the stupid questions because I don't have the answers to that.
A tank full? How's that?
Yeah. But see, now a tank is like, you know, 30 gallons or something like
that.
Yeah.
No danger of running out.
Oh, no. Again, it's all choreographed so that he takes off with as little weight as he can, which again enhances his maneuverability, but enough weight that if something were to happen to the runway here, he could go to a nearby airport and land or something like
and
that.
And what would he do if there was an emergency right now? How would he get out of that plane?
No, he's in there. Doesn't carry a weight out an airplane like
this. You know, the Navy pilot told me that the other day. The only reason you would bail out, I was told, and I never knew this before last week, is a fire.
That's right.
Really?
Yeah, a pilot hates a fire, but 99 out of 100 times they can land that thing somewhere in a field, on a highway, mm-hmm. or put it in the drink.
But what about like in Top Gun? They hopped out of that plane.
That airplane that airplane basically was out of control. And there are modes that you can get airplanes into, certainly not an airplane like this, mm-hmm. where you spin like it did in Top Gun, where you can't recover the aircraft from a particular attitude.
So you bail out.
Yeah. And anytime you're in a military airplane and you're below 10,000 feet above the ground, just to give your ejection system time to work, it's automatically an ejection sequence. If you're not under control and you got less than 10,000 feet to go in a military airplane, you're supposed to eject.
And you've crashed before, have you not?
I ejected once and crashed once.
And which did you prefer?
Neither.
I could answer that one for you.
But I ran faster when I crashed.
Oh, my.
I didn't want it to blow up behind me. The fire trucks are going one way and I was going the other.
How's he make his smoke red?
Well, he's got little smoke canisters on the wingtip. Some of the old Barnstormers used to have a calibrated leak onto the manifold. You look at old airplanes back in the heydays.
Now,
you know,
a calibrated leak on the manifold means a measured stream of gasoline hitting the engine to create smoke.
Exactly.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you very much. I just made English out of that, didn't I?
Absolutely, yes.
Bless your heart.
But nowadays, we got high tech, and he's actually got a little smoke generator in the wingtips there.
Right.
And it really enhances the ability to follow them. You see those aileron rolls, just corkscrews through the sky.
You know what it looks like, Connie? It looks like the streamer girls at a football game or something.
You bet.
You know what I mean?
Yes, you're right.
Absolutely. Now, you look at this airplane, we talk about, you know, the abuse that Leo is giving it. You know, he's got a wooden wing on it, a steel fuselage, but it's always one of those things, as new technology comes along, he's trying to put some composites into some graphite, you know, carbon fiber graphite into the wings to even make it stronger so that...
Make it lighter, too, wouldn't it?
Make it lighter and stronger, and again, you know, lessen the chance of breaking
It is Bud Light.
So cute. Thank you, Tom. How old is Leo? I mean, give us a ballpark figure here.
He's about my age, 21, 22.
22?
How are you?
You know, it's funny, about 2 weeks ago, it was my birthday. Connie said, how old are you? I said, 29 for the 16th time.
You bet, babes.
Leo is 29 plus the 16.
Just I got you.
Yeah. I got you.
He's into modern maturity.
Uh-huh. Yeah, thank you very much.
Well, when I turned 40, I took old out of my vocabulary and added mature.
There you go.
You know, we're chronologically gifted. That's another way of looking at it.
Chronologically gifted.
If he were to come down out of this plane, how would people recognize him right now?
Well, he's got a light blue flying suit on. It's got Bud Light written all over it.
Do it.
He's got a great big smile on his face, and he's also absolutely wringing wet.
He had a military career, though, didn't he?
Yes.
When he comes out of this plane, when you get out after flying like this, tell us what that's like. I mean, you've just gotten out of this plane. You've been doing all this stuff all over the world. What do you feel like?
You're tired. And in fact, Leo's body is very often bruised because no matter how hard you cinch yourself down, when you do the violence maneuvers that he does, in fact, you know, some of the Blue Angels end up with tennis elbow from coming in and out of afterburner and slamming themselves back and forth.
All right, we'll be back with more with the three of us and who's ever in the sky right after this.
Tons of them.
Absolutely.